Josh, and I am president of the College Republicans here at Dartmouth. On behalf of our organization, I would like to welcome Dinesh D'Souza, class of 1983, back to Hanover. It seldom occurs that prominent conservative alumni return to Dartmouth because of the hostile campus culture towards these alums. We are grateful to Dinesh for offering to speak with us tonight. The Dartmouth College Republicans firmly believe in a core principle on which this country was founded, that people have the right to their views and the freedom to express them. We also hold dear the American tradition of political civility and polite discourse. Mr. D'Souza will speak, followed by a question and answer session. We encourage difficult questions, but ask that you be respectful. Although we recognize the right to protest, attempts to disrupt this event and prevent our speaker from expressing himself will not be tolerated and will be met with consequences from the college. We would like to thank the college staff, safety and security officers, and everyone here at Dartmouth who helped to make this event possible. We would also like to thank the Young Americas Foundation for its sponsorship of this lecture. And on that note, this lecture is part of Young Americas Foundation's exclusive 10-campus tour, the Dinesh D'Souza Tour, Fake History Debunked. The generous, anonymous sponsors of this lecture tour ask that we share the following statement explaining why it is important that you hear from Dinesh D'Souza tonight. Here is their statement. Students deserve to receive an education based on unbiased facts, not revisionist history. Sadly, too few students today benefit from a robust understanding of the ideas and events that shape our world, because too few schools offer perspectives that challenge the leftist worldview. This is not education, it's indoctrination. And it's not just unfair to students, it is dangerous. We are alarmed that today's young people are taught to believe that freedom, the great protector against tyranny, should be forfeited in pursuit of the progressive agenda. We are sponsoring this 10-campus lecture to give you the opportunity to consider ideas that may not be taught and may not even be tolerated on your campus. You will be hearing from Dinesh D'Souza, one of today's most intelligent, articulate, and courageous scholars. We are pleased to partner with Dinesh and Young Americas Foundation to reach thousands of young people to inspire you to pursue knowledge, challenge leftist misinformation, and advance freedom and prosperity for all. May tonight's lecture inspire you to never stop learning. Now, for some information on Mr. D'Souza. Born in Mumbai, India, Dinesh D'Souza came to the United States as an exchange student and graduated Phi Beta Kappa from Dartmouth College in 1983. Since then, D'Souza has had a prominent career as a writer, scholar, and public intellectual, and has also become a renowned filmmaker. His most recent film, Death of a Nation, was released August 3, 2018 in over 1,000 theaters across the country to the dislike of critics but the praise of audiences. He earned a 90% audience approval rating on Rotten Tomatoes. One of D'Souza's favorite venues for debates and speeches has been college campuses. During the past 25 years, he has appeared at hundreds of colleges and universities and has spoken with hundreds of thousands of students in these live settings. D'Souza has been named one of America's most influential conservative thinkers by the New York Times Magazine. The World Affairs Council lists him as one of the nation's 500 leading authorities on international issues. And Newsweek cited him as one of the country's most prominent Asian Americans. We're now going to watch a short video, and then Mr. D'Souza will come on stage.
Of a searching and versatile intellect. He is a man who can bridge cultures and understands history and scholarship and politics and theology and philosophy.
My guest this week is an author, a filmmaker, a former policy advisor to Ronald Reagan,
Mr. Dinesh D'Souza.
American dream is a dream not just of economic opportunity or success, but it's ultimately a dream where you can be the architect of your own destiny.
I grew up in a different world, actually a world without America. And although I grew up without a phone, without television, without hot water, we had a car, but if you looked down the floor of our car, you could see the ground.
He's been described as an influential conservative thinker. He's a best-selling author, political commentator, and filmmaker.
The great man, Dinesh D'Souza, a patriotic man.
No longer would I say that I live in a rarefied world of intellectual debate. I've seen the upside of America, and I've seen the downside of America. But at the end of the day, I wouldn't trade the United States for any other country. At the end of the day, my enthusiasm for American government may have dimmed, but my enthusiasm for this country burns brighter than ever. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dinesh D'Souza.
Thank you very much. Wow. I am, can you hear me okay? I'm really thrilled and excited to be here, my alma mater. It was, seems forever that I first set foot on the Dartmouth campus at the age of 18, and quite truly it changed my life. A lot of who I am and a lot of the way I think was, believe it or not, shaped here. I want to share with you, talk to you, in a candid way, about some of the big issues that I think are shaping our country. I'm especially thrilled to be here with my wife, Debbie. Where are you? Right here. Debbie is a Latina from Venezuela. And has seen a once prosperous country, an oil-rich country, a country that once actually had political diversity and political debate, be essentially run into the ground by policies that are perhaps not unfamiliar to us here in America and on this campus. I'm also glad my daughter Danielle is here. She's class of 2017. And here we are, and we have some dissenters outside, and I would be happy to engage those ideas as well in the question and answer session. I want to think in my talk about walls, not just the wall, but walls in general, and walls in the context of some larger questions that have to do with identity and belonging. And who gets to be inside the wall, and who gets to be outside a wall, and why? I remember when I first showed up at Dartmouth, this was actually yesterday, I looked around and I thought to myself, wow, this is such an incredible open campus. I don't see any walls. It's real easy to just stroll on the campus. And then I realized that that's actually not true. And anyone who thinks that true isn't really looking hard, because Dartmouth has much higher walls than Trump wants to build, and those walls are actually controlled by the admissions office. The wall has to do with who gets to be a member of the Dartmouth community, and that wall is jealously guarded and limited to 1,000 students every year, excluding more than 10 times that number that want to come in, perhaps more. And this wall is guarded so diligently and ruthlessly that, to my knowledge, in the entire history of the college, there has not been a single person who has jumped the wall. And what I mean by that is, it possible for somebody who is not a Dartmouth student to sneak into Dartmouth, take courses for 4 years, and leave with a Dartmouth degree. It turns out, to my knowledge, that it's completely impossible. It has never happened. And that means that this wall is protected far more savagely, jealously, and determinedly than any wall that we could possibly put around this country. Any wall that we put would necessarily be porous. This wall, as far as I can tell, is completely opaque. I want to start by talking a little bit about poetry, and then I'm going to pivot to politics. And I want to talk about poetry for the simple reason that we have connected with Dartmouth a poet, I have to say, of some subtlety, who talks about walls, and talks about walls in a kind of complex way. And in a way, this is a very nice portal to thinking about walls in general. It gives us, if you will, a little bit of an aesthetic vantage point. We can learn from Frost's New England toughness, his realism, his skepticism, his willingness to see things from more than one angle. I discovered Frost at Dartmouth, and to me, he was just a completely refreshing contrast with romantic poets like Wordsworth, whom I was more familiar with. All this talk about daffodils, and all this talk about the beauty of nature. But what about the deer, its leg caught in the tendrils of nature? What about the vicious beauty of nature? What about the harshness of nature? And Frost had this ability to capture that too. But reading Frost is kind of tricky, as I discovered myself here on campus. One of the first poems I learned about in connection with Frost was, of course, the famous, or perhaps infamous, poem about the road not taken. A very self-congratulatory poem. I took the road less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. In short, I'm just a super fantastic guy. I made the tough choices that have made me into the remarkable personality that I am. Is this actually Frost's message in the poem? This was the message I took when I first read the poem. And yet, reading the poem again and again, and then with some guidance from a campus Virgil, if I can say so, you begin to pay attention to the poem. And that's what I want to suggest for a moment. Let's pay attention to the poem. Verse 2. Then took the other. He's looking down two roads. He says, just as fair. The other road is just as fair. And then the key lines, though as for that, the passing there had warned them really about the same. In other words, he looks down the first road, he looks down the other road, and the two roads are the same. He can't tell a difference. It's not a less traveled road. It is the same. And what that means is that the poem really is about the difficulty of choice. The poem is really about the fact that life has to be lived forward, but knowledge, in a sense, only obtains backward. When you graduate from Dartmouth, you decide, am I going to go to law school or become a poet? Am I going to become an engineer or am I going to work on Wall Street? And which life is going to be better for me? And Frost is saying, you don't know. The roads are worn about the same. I think it was Hegel who said that the owl of Minerva flies by night, by which Hegel meant that we only understand history in retrospect. Only looking back can we assign meaning to history, but meaning invisible to the people who actually live there. They couldn't see it. And so it is with us. Looking back, we go, wow, I made the right decision. Oh, I made the wrong decision. But for you at the time, there is actually, it is very difficult to know. And so ironically, the skepticism of the poem cuts against the naive reading. And this is Frost. This is kind of the way he does it. And so with that, by the way, of preamble, I want to turn to Frost's poem, Mending Wall. Kind of a strange title for a poem, Mending Wall. And the poem on the face of it is about why walls are terrible. This is the point of view of the narrator of the poem. Something there is that doesn't love a wall. What's the something? He doesn't say. Implying that it's something rather vague, a feeling. I just don't like the idea of a wall. And we can all sympathize with that. I'm telling you, as an immigrant who has been on both sides of the wall, I totally get it. There's something in me that doesn't love a wall. And yet the poem ends on the opposite note. The last line, good fences make good neighbors. Uttered not by the narrator, but by the other guy. The non-narrator. You may say the target of the narrator. And throughout the poem, the narrator is railing on the other guy. He's a brute. He's a savage. And all the while that he's railing, the other guy is putting up parts of the wall in between their two properties. And the other guy doesn't say a lot. And the narrator continues to bloviate. Walls are bad. You're a savage. But you notice something that he never does. He never actually tries to stop the wall from being built. He does nothing to actually knock the wall down. And there's something else he doesn't do. He never claims that he has any rights on the other side of the wall. At no point does the narrator ever say, you know what? I have the right to come and take the fruit off of your trees. I have the right to come and eat out of your refrigerator. I wouldn't mind climbing into bed with your wife. All of this is the, you almost say, this is the unspoken script of the poem. The only objection to the wall that the narrator seems to have is he just doesn't like the notion of a wall. It offends him somehow. It offends a kind of universalism that I would argue is built right into the American experience, is built right into the Declaration of Independence. All men are created equal. Not all Americans, all men. So there's a universalism asserted there. But notice that this notion that all men are created equal is itself an American idea. I don't find it in anybody else's charter of emancipation. And so you have American exceptionalism united to American universalism in a very interesting way. And I think that is really the heart of our debate tonight. Frost likes to talk about coming at the truth sort of slantwise, his term, slantwise. And I think that's a very good way to think about our political debate. Because here we have Trump, a very different character than Frost, I will have to admit. Frost is grumpy, taciturn, philosophical. Trump is Trump. He is, as my wife says, a bit out there. And yet, we have to remember that Trump is playing a very different role than Frost. Frost, if you will, is the poet. If you will, you can call him a philosopher poet. Trump is a statesman, a leader. If you don't like the dignity of that term, a politician. But this distinction is of critical importance because, and this may not be very obvious when you're on campus, but it's very obvious when you're out in the world, at some point, the necessary skepticism of thought has to give way to the necessary dogmatism of action. And what I mean by that is that at some point, it's not enough to say, on the one hand and on the other hand, something there is that doesn't love a wall. Good fences make good neighbors. Well, are you going to build the damn thing or no? At some point, you got to go. You got to decide. You've got to move. You got to take a decision. And if you decide not to do it, that's your decision. And so Trump is out there making a case for the wall. And yet on the face of it, his case is manifestly inadequate. Trump says, we need to have a wall for three reasons. One, drug traffickers. Two, violent criminals. And three, sex traffickers. We have to stop, in other words, the bad guy. Now, that argument by itself may be true or may not be true, but is clearly insufficient, because the wall may stop those people, but it would certainly stop a whole lot of other people too. Let's call them the good guys, people who just want to come here for a better life for themselves and their families, and a wall would clearly do that too. So the real case for the wall can't just talk about the bad guys, it also has to consider the case for stopping some good guys. On the other side of the debate, you've got all the people who say that Trump hates immigrants. Now, this argument that Trump hates immigrants relies on making a very squid-like confusion between the immigrant and the illegal. Notice the people say, whoa, whoa, illegal immigrants. Illegals are not actually immigrants. Illegals are people who essentially want to jump the line. There is a big line. And there are some people, and I would put myself in this category, who were born a very long ways away from America. Quite frankly, we don't have a Rio Grande that we can come thrashing across or a ditch that we can tunnel under to get to America. We actually have to get here by a very circuitous and lengthy route. It costs a lot of money, it costs a lot of tears, and sometimes it takes a generation. And yet, why does our welfare count less than somebody who happens to be just across the border, who basically says, I don't care about this line. I'm going to jump it. And because I am a tragic humanitarian figure, I'm going to rely on the goodwill of the other side, the people on the other side of the line, to sacrifice not them, but Dinesh, who's too far away to get here this way, and I'm going to do that in the name of humanity. So you can see right away that there's a complexity here. America actually has a pretty generous immigration policy. We let in about 1 million legal immigrants a year. I wouldn't object to increasing that number, and we set rules for what kind of immigrants we want. I don't like those rules. The rules, as I see it, are dumb. Quite frankly, I happen to have come to America alone as an exchange student. In fact, I only got my visa here at Dartmouth. I took the Montrealer up to Canada. I got an extension. That's how I was able to stay in this country. And so, the point I'm trying to make is that the rules, family unification, which is perhaps the centerpiece of our immigration policy, if I had really worked at it over the last 35 years, I could have probably brought 100 people to America under family unification. It was intended to be for people to bring their spouses, but the way it works is something like this. I sponsor my wife, I sponsor my parents, they sponsor my other siblings, they sponsor their wives, they sponsor their parents, and this is how the game is played. And everybody who has been through or near the process knows it. It's a scam. It's a scam. It's not what the law was meant to do. So we have a broken immigration system. That is actually not what we are debating here. Before I jump into the immigration debate and the wall debate head on, I want to ask a different kind of question. Why do people actually want to come here? What does it mean to come to America? In a weird way, this question is a question that points directly to what can be called American exceptionalism. Because American exceptionalism is the reason people want to come. There's something about America that makes it a magnet for people around the world. And if I were to say in my own life what that magnet was, it actually wasn't material prosperity. Most people think it's, oh, Dinesh, wow, he's lived the Horatio Alger story. He's been successful in America. Well, my dad was a chemical engineer. My mom was a housewife. I grew up without great luxury, but not lacking for anything. My life in America, is it materially better than it was in India? Yes. But that is actually not a radical difference. My life has changed more in other ways. If I stayed in India, where I was born, chances are very high I would have become an engineer like my dad, or a doctor like one of my uncles. Chances are I would have married a woman of my identical economic and socioeconomic and perhaps caste background. Chances are I would have a whole set of views on a bunch of topics that could be easily predicted in advance and would be not very different from what my dad believed or my grandfather. And what I'm trying to say is my destiny would to a large degree have been given to me. By coming here to Dartmouth, my horizons widen. By coming here to Dartmouth, I realize, wow, this is a place where I can write, if you will, the script of my own life. I can be in the driver's seat of my own future. I can do things with my life that would simply be unavailable if I were to stay put where I was. Now, this belief that became implanted in me here at Dartmouth contradicted a doctrine that I was simultaneously taught at Dartmouth, a doctrine that's very powerful today. It's the doctrine of, you may call it, cultural relativism. It's the philosophical underpinning of the idea of diversity. And what does cultural relativism mean? It means very simply that no culture is better or worse, superior or inferior to any other. All cultures are equal. And yet this notion of cultural equality, once again, tempting as it is to believe, I realized is manifestly untrue to my own life. Why? Because every immigrant is a walking refutation of cultural relativism. Every immigrant is voting in the most decisive way possible. I mean, think about it. We're born into a certain world. This is our family. This is our school. This is the only world we know. We're attached to it. We can't not be attached to it. Well, I guess this is what they call hate speech. I gotta be more careful. You think I'd have been slinging insults since I walked in here. No, the point I'm trying to make is we're all attached to our own. And for the immigrant, not the refugee, but for the immigrant to voluntarily move from his or her own culture to another culture is a very powerful statement that, from my point of view, I am making a decisive judgment that this other culture that I'm moving to is better for me than the culture that I'm leaving. It's a vote, if you will, in the most meaningful way possible against the doctrine that all cultures are equal, because the fact of the matter is if all cultures were truly equal, nobody would ever leave home. Now, America is a country that works, but it's part worth thinking about, what is it about America that works well? When I talked to a friend of mine in India, he's been trying to come to America for almost 20 years now, and he has never been able to do it. And finally, I said to him, why are you so eager to come to America? He goes, Dinesh, I want to move to a country where the poor people are fat. And this is part of what's great about America. It's American abundance. It's American prosperity. It's actually what we take for granted. It is the prosperity that actually enables one to entertain ideas of socialism. Why? Because socialism seems to make sense when there is so much abundance. That's why in Ocasio-Cortez's memo, she can say, we want to provide entitlements for people even if they are unwilling, not just unable, but unwilling to work. You have to be a really rich country to even think crazy thoughts like that. But it's American abundance that makes that possible. Now, let's turn from American abundance and what's attractive about America to immigration. And let's think about the way in which immigration has really changed in this country. And by that I mean, we often talk about immigrants, but we never talk about what kind of immigrants. What kind of immigrants? Years ago, I read a sociologist who made a very provocative claim. He said, the quality of an immigrant who moves from country A to country B is directly proportional to the distance traveled to get from country A to country B. Kind of a startling observation. But his argument was, it has nothing to do with the race or ethnicity or even the socioeconomic status of immigrants. The basic idea is that the longer the distance you have to go to another country, the more entrepreneurial, creative, dogged, persistent, hardworking you have to be to pull it off. And so in general, a country can count on immigrants who come from a long distance away to actually be the kind of immigrants that the country probably really wants. We never talk about what kind of immigrants we want. If you go to Australia or Canada, other countries that take immigrants, there's a burning debate. Who do we want? What kind of people do we want here? And very often that debate is very pragmatic. We here in Australia need nurses. Let's let in a bunch of nurses. That's what we want. We want entrepreneurs. We want people who have a lot of cash. Let's let those people in. In America, we sort of repress that debate. And I think this is important because, as a country, it's worth thinking honestly and politically about what kind of immigrants we want. Now, a few years ago, I got into some kind of a minor fracas with the Obama administration. Resulting in a brief incarceration. It was a garden variety case, to quote my prosecutor, my fellow Indian, Preet Bharara. But it was a heck of a garden variety case because it resulted in a garden variety presidential pardon and a garden variety firing of Preet Bharara. But nevertheless, here we are. And in the course of this, of my penance had many dimensions to it. One dimension to it was I had to undergo psychiatric examinations to steer my thoughts in a more hospitable direction. Months later, I was pronounced by the judge to be incurable on that point. And my other penance was to teach English to non-English speaking Latinos, for the most part. And in one of these classes, I was asked this question, which is to say, what is the main division in America between the two political parties? And it was asked in the context of someone who was, I'm not even sure legal or illegal, to be honest, but someone who wanted to become an American. And they were asking, what is the real difference from our point of view, and our, in this case, included me, how do the two parties differ as you see it? Someone who's been in America, someone who sort of looks at the political system, what's the difference? And it was very hard for me to say because here's not somebody to whom I could refer to the Constitution or Publius or the Federalist Papers or any of that. Here's someone who wanted me to talk on a different level completely. And so I answered this way. I said, look, in America, as I understand it, we have two parties, two sides. One I'm going to call the party of the ladder, and the other I'm going to call the party of the rope. The party of the ladder is a party that believes that America is represented, metaphorically, by a ladder of opportunity, and that the government has a role, and the role is to hold the ladder. And hold the ladder here means to protect our constitutional rights. It's our job to climb. And how high we get, how far we advance in life, is going to largely depend on how we climb. Not exclusively on us. It's going to depend in part on our industry, our creativity, our intelligence, but it's also going to depend on chance. But your fate, if you will, on the ladder is largely, not entirely, but largely up to you. And this is the party of the ladder. I actually agree with this philosophy. The other party I'm going to call the party of the rope. And the party of the rope operates somewhat differently. It's more like this. You have a building, and it's a tall building, and you have a group of people on top of the building, and they're the ones looking down at all the poor immigrants down there. And the people on top of the building say, hey guys, we really don't believe in the ladder. In fact, we think the ladder is an illusion. There are no ladders really in America when you look hard enough. However, do not despair, because we are going to be letting down a rope. Your job for a creature, hang on to the rope. Do nothing else. We will pull you up. Now, when I first heard about this or thought about things this way, I thought to myself, wow, the rope is far more attractive than the ladder. Why? Because in a ladder, you actually have to climb. In the rope, you'd basically do nothing except hold on. But it also occurred to me that with the rope, you are dependent on the people who are holding the rope. If they let go, down you go. And not only that, but if you actually do a little bit of empirical checking and you really pay attention at what's happening, not just in our inner cities, but in the Latino barrios of America and the Native American reservations, you notice something remarkable. That the people who are being pulled up by the rope never seem to get to the top of the building. They are pulled up, and then the people on top hold, suspending you in midair, in which you are a long distance back from the ground, too far to jump, and yet your advancement appears to be halted. And it crosses your mind that maybe the people on the top of the building have no intention of pulling me up. Because if they were to pull me up, I would become one of them. I would dust myself off and walk off. And that's not what they need. They've got me right where they want me. And now we have to ask the question, what are they doing this for? What is the point of holding people in this suspended abeyance? And the answer, of course, is that what you want out of them is the one thing that they have the power to give you. Poor though they are, lacking prospects though they are, lacking food perhaps though they may be, or healthcare, they do have one thing that costs them nothing, that is to you everything, and that is their vote. And so as long as you can consolidate their votes, you've got them where you want them. So in my view, not only is this the ideological fork in America, but you can actually see two types of immigrants who respond to the incentives that are offered on both sides of the aisle. There's one type of immigrant who says, I'm the immigrant of the ladder. I don't actually want ropes. I'll pull myself up. Just hold the ladder. Just protect my rights. And I am counting on America to offer the freedom, the opportunity for me to make my way. And if I fall flat on my face, that will actually be my doing. And there's another type of immigrant who goes, wow, we have things kind of rough over here. I didn't even know there was a country where all I've got to do is hold on to a rope. They're telling me I don't have to work. In fact, they would rather I not. Why? Because then my dependency on them is greater and my vote for them more reliable. And this is a bargain that I'm actually willing to make. What does my vote cost me? Nothing. And so if I can get a set of meager provisions of food and housing and health care, it may not actually be a very good life, but it's a life nonetheless. And it's perhaps a better life than I have here. So I'm going to go for it. And so what you have here is not only two reciprocal, an ideology on this side that, if you will, is pulling, but you also have immigrants of two different types who are pushing. And which ideology prevails is going to determine what kind of immigrants we get in America. Are we going to get immigrants of the ladder, or are we going to get immigrants of the rope? Now, I want to say a word. I'm almost out of time. I want to leave time for questions. Just going to say a word about the Democratic Party. And this is motivated by the notion that progressive historiography, which is mostly what I would say we all learn, what I learned, suppresses the complicity of the Democratic Party in the great crimes of American politics. It is hardly an exaggeration to say that most of the things for which Democrats indict America, or Republicans, or the white man, or even the South, were not done by America, or the white man, or even the South, but were actually primarily driven by the Democratic Party itself. It's the accuser who is actually guilty of the crime. It's the guy who poisoned the waters who's pretending to show up as the water commissioner. Now, to prove this would actually take more than I can possibly do here, but I'm just going to sum up by saying that the Democratic Party is, without dispute, in this country's history, the party that promoted slavery, segregation, Jim Crow, racial terrorism, the Ku Klux Klan, and it was the main party in opposition to the civil rights laws of the 1960s. I have documented this in rather excruciating detail, but I want to leave you with just a single tidbit that to me illustrates the degree to which even those of us in this room, educated, smart, having gone to the best schools and are here at one of the best schools, but nevertheless don't know things because they're not in our textbooks and we're not told them. So in 1860, the year before the Civil War, I would point to the Democratic Party and what its complicity in slavery, by the way, Democrats North and South. And inevitably on campus, someone would say to me, "But Dinesh, you've got to realize that this is a very simplistic argument. You're pointing your finger in one direction. Surely there's a lot of blame to go around." And this is the kind of thing that I would say my career exists to crush, which is the attempt ultimately to evade the issue by backing up and throwing, if you will, a squid-like cloud of obfuscation over the whole matter. There's plenty of blame to go around. Actually, no. And the proof of it is that in 1860, the year before the Civil War, no Republican owned a slave. I pause. Not no Republican leader owned a slave. It's my contention that no Republican in the United States owned a slave. And that means that all the slaves in the entire country, 4 million of them at the time, were owned by Democrats. Now, that's hate speech if you're looking for it. But it's not just hate speech, it's a scientific statement in the sense that it opens itself to what Popper calls refutability. Refutability. All you have to do is give me the names of 3 Republicans who owned slaves, and I would have to take it back. But to this date, 3 years after I first made this claim, not a single valid counterexample has surfaced. And what does that tell you? That tells you that there's not plenty of blame to go around, that slavery was one-sidedly promoted by one party and opposed by the other party. Do you know that every segregation law in the South, from the beginning to the end, was passed by a Democratic legislature, signed by a Democratic governor, and put into effect by Democratic officials, and that there's not a single exception to that rule? And yet, these facts that I'm telling you now do not appear, to my knowledge, in a single textbook. They do not appear on the History Channel or on NPR. They're not in Wikipedia if you type it in there. And why not? They're true, but they have been suppressed by progressive historiography. What I'm trying to say is that history, somebody made it. And the somebodies who made it found inconvenient facts that they thought it better not to say or not to emphasize. And part of my education, if you will, as an immigrant, has been to open my eyes to all of this and to see, as with Frost, the repressed truth that goes unsaid that is perhaps more important than what is said on the surface. My life was changed by Dartmouth, and I hope your lives will be too. This is a great institution, and that's why I sent my daughter here. It's an institution whose strength depends on free debate, open discussion, thoughtful consideration. I may be wrong, I may be right, but I think you'll agree that I've tried to speak in an open spirit, saying, calling it as I see it, and not engaging in any kind of wanton hatred or antagonism toward anybody. Intellectual diversity is very important, and I hope that you will become, partly as a consequence of this, its ruthless defenders, standing up for it against those who would use a certain kind of very powerful social intimidation. No, it's not George Orwell. It's not a boot stamping on your face. It's more the soft despotism that Tocqueville talked about that pushes you up against the wall, that makes it awkward and embarrassing for you to defend even your most cherished beliefs. And my suggestion, my advice, my exhortation is resist that pressure. And in resisting it, you will be freeing the space for others, ultimately bringing down walls is most important in the intellectual sense, because the bringing down of the intellectual wall is the opening of the American mind. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, we will commence questions and answer. The line will start over there. Griffin, if you could wave your smile and wave, thank you. You will come up to this X, you will stand there, I will hold the mic. You may ask only one question, no follow-ups, must be in the form of a question. Once you are done, you shall return down this aisle, unless you sit in these three rows. Thank you.
Hi, Dinesh. It is uncomfortable for me to be here because I don't necessarily identify with a lot of the politics that you support. I do think what you do is brave, just because a lot of people would try to make you be quiet. And so whether or not I agree with it doesn't really matter. The rope that I climbed and used was 5 years of service in the United States Armed Forces. Right? So, the ladder you reference, to me, is hidden behind a couple of barriers that not everyone has access to. I wouldn't be here getting this education if it weren't for that rope. And so, that's anecdotal. I just wanted to say thank you for what you provided us.
Do you mind if I ask you a question? When you joined the Army, you gave them something in return for what they gave you. Why would you count that as a rope instead of a ladder?
Because the idea of military service being mandatory in some places and not mandatory in others, to some people it can act as a welfare program. I've seen people consider it such. And so not everyone has the opportunity to join the military based on medical issues or other things so that, again, they don't have access to the thing that I did. But my question for you is more based on discourse. In a climate right now with what's going on outside and what can happen in here, the word bigot being thrown around, how do we maintain a level of intellectual discourse that keeps conversation happening instead of not happening? And then how do you also, because you've made mistakes that you admit to, how do you check yourself? And then do you have people in your life that check you when you make mistakes?
Yes. I think that the whole experience that I went through with regard to my case, forced confinement. I found myself in a totally different world. I had been used to the rarefied world of political debate. In fact, I thought of American politics as a debate. We've got these two sides, and it's kind of like a great clash of ideas. And it's frankly only by seeing politics from the other side, in fact, in some cases from behind bars, and seeing other people with me locked up, and realizing, look, I'm a controversial political figure, I'll land on my feet when I get out of here. These people's lives are completely destroyed. Their American dream is actually gone. And my American dream will probably come back. I couldn't at that time anticipate the phone call I received when I was in my office this past May, which is, hello, this is the White House operator, hold the line for the President of the United States. That's a good call to get. And I held the line, and it was Trump, and he was in a very Trumpian mood. By pardoning me, he gave me my American dream back. But what I'm saying is the journey, very eye-opening, very introspective. You only have to be locked up with a bunch of guys who are in for their coyotes, drug smugglers, murderers, rapists, sleeping next to you and talking to you every day to realize my life has actually taken a Boethian twist here, and I have to learn from that. And the best I can do is come out better at the other end of it. So I've tried to do that. Now, the other part of your question is this use of the word bigot. You got to be very careful, because when I was here at Dartmouth, I was a freshman here in the aftermath of what's called the Berkeley Free Speech Movement. And it was all these guys who were like, free speech, free speech, free speech. And we supported them. Our newspaper on campus was partly modeled on the Berkeley barb that was behind this kind of activism. It's only later I realized that when those guys take control, they will immediately start suppressing the speech of others. In other words, they don't actually believe in free speech. They believe in free speech for them. Bigot is a very loaded term. And because it has real sting and applies to real people, there's an effort to try to pin it on people. See, like these guys are walking out, they're too lazy to debate with me. They're not going to. I mean, they aren't. They aren't. Because, I'll tell you why. Hold on. Look, I'm here. I'm here.
Institution and the standards that this institution upholds, for you to say that they're lazy is kind of a bit.
I'm not
out
saying
of
that they're lazy people. I'm simply saying that they are not willing to do the intellectual work to stand up face to face with me. Look, if I said those things on those posters, and if I believe them, and if they're all true, this is a slam dunk against me. All someone has to do is stand up here, quote my own words back to me in the complete confidence that I would have no rebuttal. Right? And crush me. And I'm saying they can't do that, and they're not going to, or if they will, I'm actually anticipating that and waiting for it, but it hasn't happened yet. So I'm just saying that the enemy of free speech is not me. The enemy of free speech are the people who would rather have that I never came, that they never would have to have that kind of debate, that they would win this confrontation by default. Now, with me here, they're not going to win it by default, I'll give you that. I'm very happy to go into it, but I'm just saying, if you want the debate to occur, let it occur. But I'm not the one that makes you awkward. I'm not the one intimidating you. You've been squirming the whole time you've been talking to me, and I'm just saying, they're the reason for it. Acknowledge that. You're being respectful. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that the discomfort that you started confessing, you said, I feel very awkward being here. I'm saying, who's making it awkward for you? Is the college Republicans making it awkward for you?
Are they making it awkward? I think the idea that everyone in this room is so polarized is what makes it uncomfortable. Because I occupy a space somewhere in the middle that makes being a black woman really hard. And you, calling them lazy, was a lazy pot shot on your behalf. And them holding that poster and interrupting this was lazy on their behalf. So that's my question about responsible, dignified, intelligent discourse was aimed at you because you have the podium, and I want you to encourage people to do that rather than that.
Understood. And I will try, I'm going to try by example to do that tonight. Okay?
Hi, Dinesh.
Hey.
Thanks for coming. And I'm sorry, but I'm just a little confused. You started off by talking about Dartmouth and intellectual diversity. Then you moved on to discuss walls and their philosophical backing. Then you talked about your experiences as an illegal immigrant.
What's the question?
But, so, you touched on a large number of topics, and you touched on a lot of them lightly, but none in detail. So my question is, was your goal here to change minds by putting forward a concerted argument? If so, what was it, and do you think you might change more minds by staying on a singular topic?
I recognize that a talk like this is in an awkward position, because the stuff that I'm going to say to you, you're probably going to hear only once. The other side is bombarding you every day. If I make an if I want to cover a certain ground, let's just say a word about the Democratic Party, say a word about walls, I'm going to have to do a little bit of intellectual leapfrogging just to be able to introduce ideas that I only get one shot at sharing with you. So I could have chosen to do a very close reading of a Frost poem, or discuss purely the glitches in current immigration policy. But if that's the only conservatism you get this year, I feel like I would be doing you a disservice. There's so much I want to say that, a little bit like a fire hose, I've got to give a few squirts in different directions. Look, I have innumerable YouTube videos that zoom into these topics. I've written books on them. I've done 2 books on the history of the Democratic Party alone. So there's more there. What this talk I'm hoping will be is, to use Kant's phrase, a prolegomena, an introduction, a gateway to ideas that I hope you'll check out for yourself.
Okay.
Thanks for coming to speak with us. I wanted your points on civil action within the millennial generation. So you talked about the party of the ladder and the party of the rope. So what do you think we as the college generation can do to make sure the ladder's not broken?
The difficulty of the ladder, a difficulty, by the way, recognized by the founders and recognized by observers in America like Tocqueville, is that it is sustained not only by the strength of the ladder, but by the inner strength of the people who are climbing the ladder. If the guy who's climbing the ladder becomes discouraged and says, "I can't climb a ladder," he's going to be tempted to move over and hold on to the rope. The appeal, if you will, of the rope is the appeal to sloth. It's an appeal to helplessness. It's an appeal to ultimately freeze yourself into a life of helplessness in which you not only come to see yourself as a victim, but you relish it. Victimhood actually becomes your identity. And this, I think, is the moral tragedy of the rope, is it crushes your soul. It takes souls that are actually capable, enterprising, and creative. And instead of building their creativity, it squashes them. It demoralizes them. I may seem to be talking in metaphor, but literally, one day, just drive the Pine Ridge Reservation, Indian Reservation in South Dakota, and look, and you will see the philosophy of the rope played out. Just drive a barrio in South Texas. Debbie grew up in the Rio Grande Valley. People live by the rope. you can see it, and you can see that their souls have been flattened, and in a way, the creative life has been drained out of them. And the only self-respect that they have is ultimately to say that the reason I am in this miserable state is somebody did it to me. To which my answer is, yes, somebody did do it to you. That somebody is the Democratic Party.
This will be our last question of the night.
Hey, Dinesh, thanks for coming out. So near the end of the talk, you discussed the historical legacy of the Democratic Party. And one thing that's often brought up, and I apologize in advance because I'm not very knowledgeable at the topic, but one thing that's often brought up when discussing the historical legacies of either party is a sort of party shift that's occurred over time, say since the Civil War to now. Do you think that your idea of the historical legacy of the Democratic Party and maybe even the Republican Party fits in with that ideological shift that occurred between the Civil War and the present?
So the question is a very good one, and it has to do with the fact that was there a big switch between the parties? Typically, the people who say this argue that since the 1960s, in response to the civil rights movement, the parties, if you will, swapped platforms. And the proof of this is very simple, that the racist Dixiecrats, I define a Dixiecrat as somebody who joined the Dixiecrat Party or voted against the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 65 and the Fair Housing Bill of 68. So this is a Dixiecrat. The racist Dixiecrats became Republicans. Now, this is an empirical question. Did the racist Dixiecrats become Republicans? In my last movie, Death of a Nation, I say, let us count. And up on the screen go the 150 or so names of the racist Dixiecrats, and they're all there. And then we count how many of the racist Dixiecrats became Republicans, and the correct answer to that question is 2. In the House, one guy, Albert Watson. In the Senate, one guy, Strom Thurmond. And all the other racist Dixiecrats lived and stayed and died in the Democratic Party. They are lionized to this day, and there are buildings in Washington, D.C. named after them. So the fact of the matter is that there was no big switch. Yes, blacks did switch from Republican to Democrat, but they did that in the 1930s in response to the economic promises of FDR and the New Deal. That had nothing to do with race. It was an economic proposition through and through. So what I'm getting at is that things are known to us as intelligent people that are not true. And this, I think, puts a lot of intellectual pressure on us and on me. Because when I say things on campus, people look like me like, he's crazy. Why? Because that's not in the History Channel. And that's not in Wikipedia. And that's not what my professor said. And that's not what I read in Barnes & Noble. And the reason I like to bring these things down to empirical particulars is because they're checkable. My greatest ally is we live in a time where you can check on your phone. So pull out your phone. Pardon me?
I have checked on my phone. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I won't be allowed to ask you this. So
it's okay. Let her go. Okay, tell me.
Has in fact shown you all the statistics that you claim are untrue. What you say about the Southern Democrats is not unknown. I am in fact an immigrant like you. I come from the same country that you come from. And I am not here to debate Democrat versus Republican. I am simply disappointed because you are producing facts that are simply not true.
Name one.
And you are not a historian. For example, the party realignment, there you should just go check your own Twitter page. This has been...
Believe me, I have.
Yes, so have I. So have I. Yeah. And I can see that you've been missing...
Okay, let's pause. We need to situate what you're talking, because you're making references here that need to be brought out. There is a historian at Princeton named Kevin Cruz. And Cruz and I have been having a kind of a Twitter fight, if you will, about Dixiecrats. Now, Cruz plays a very sly game. He counts as Dixiecrats people who are not Dixiecrats. And so if I say to him, only 2 racist Dixiecrats became Republicans, he goes, what about John Tower? What about Jesse Helms? What about Trent Lott? And my response is, don't be an idiot. We're talking about Dixiecrats. None of those were...
History. He cannot be an idiot.
Hold on.
This is literally history.
It's not his research. He has written one book on white flight in Atlanta. Hold on. Hold on. Let's. Guys, hold on. I think what he's trying to say is that somewhat like the illegal, you want to jump the line. Hold on. Don't shout. Don't heckle me. One second. First of all, I was the person who said, let her speak. No, I didn't cut her off. Okay. All right. Hold on. I'm going to do one more thing. And that is there anybody who's in the audience that wants to ask me a question about the posters on the campus? Because if they do, I'm happy to directly address. I obviously can't address. There was a kind of a blizzard of things out there. Some of them actually not even said by me. But nevertheless, if anyone wants to take a shot, I think it's kind of a nice way to close the evening. If one person wants to ask a question related to, oh, this guy, okay, he's ready. We'll pick him as a representative of the resistance. Okay, go for it. Go for it.
About your, you worked in the Reagan administration, obviously, for a while. I want to read you a quote from your former boss. It says, talking about immigrants in a speech, they brought with them courage, ambition, and the values of family, neighborhood, work, peace, and freedom. And then he goes on to talk about how immigrants are making this country great, and then he says, make America great again. I'm wondering what your own former boss would say about you now.
So the question is, quoting Reagan, my hero, and a lot of the reason I became a conservative, about how immigrants are entrepreneurial, hardworking, pro-family, and the question, and I just want to excavate the buried assumption of the question, how disappointed your former boss would be in you now. Now, I would submit that nobody would ask a question like that who actually was listening to what I said tonight. I actually believe that immigrants are hardworking, industrious, entrepreneurial. I said I would like to see the number of legal immigrants in this country increased. I would like to see our immigration policy modified to take far more of those kinds of immigrants. My position on immigration is thoroughly and completely Reaganite. Now, what gets me is when I hear things that revolt against what I know and also against common sense. And so there are things that people will sometimes say, like, immigrants created this country and built this country. True, but only partially true, because that distinction confuses actually two groups that are not the same, immigrants and settlers. Settlers. Colonizers, if you will. Colonizers. Okay, let's call them colonizers. Colonizers. Here's the important thing. Colonizers create
genocide.
Why are you shouting? Hold on. It's not, we can have a whole debate on that. But let me address your point. Colonizers create the country that immigrants want to come to. Think of that paradox right there. In other words, if the colonizers were such horrible guys and have done such a botched up job of creating this country, why on earth today do immigrants from all over the world still want to come here? Why do we even have to talk about a wall in the knowledge that if we didn't have a wall, half the world would come here? What was it about those colonizers, despite their colonization, that was so powerful that 150 years later, the country that they made is still the magnet for the world? So immigrants like me will jump over fences, stand in lines, pay a lot of money, abandon our families to come to the country the colonizers made. Now, we're... All right, let's make this the last question in fairness, and I will have extended the time. Go for it. It's your, the mic is yours.
Why is it that the very descendants of the people that lived here before colonizers came in are the ones that are almost the most marginalized in this country and systematically suffering because of that?
Yes, I'll try to answer that as best I can. The condition of the American Indians historically, we have to look at it twofold, historically and today. Historically, it was the Indian Wars, the broken treaties by the white man, the wounded knee, the battles, the massacres. It was also a plethora of diseases that spread through the Indian population brought by the white man, and that decimated the American Indian population.
It was also, intentionally introduced, right?
No, that's not true. There's a debate about Jeffrey Amherst, and there's a controversial episode there. But look, diseases, there's a book I recommend to you by the historian William McNeil. It's called Plagues and Peoples. It talks about how massive populations have been decimated historically by diseases brought by outsiders. For example, the Black Plague in Europe killed one third of the entire continent, brought from Asia, unintentionally. Now, I'm not going to say that's genocide, because genocide implies a deliberate intention to exterminate an entire population. That's why the use of the term genocide is very irresponsible on your part in this case. You don't think so? You think, and I'm going to ask you now for your evidence, that there was a conscious intention to wipe out the Indians as a people. Chapter and verse. Let's hear it.
So, what do you say about the very thing that this institution was initially founded on, about essentially whitewashing the Native Americans? And then that was, of course, abandoned, but all of these things. But what do you say about the foundational thing for Indian schools that were created, and then there were things about headhunting Indians and prizes for that money? Like, it was a clear incentivization by both the U.S. government and just by people to be able to take over the property, the land, the things that people had here before the colonizers.
So Eliezer Wheelock leaves Yale and comes up here into the woods of New Hampshire to set up a college to Christianize and educate the Native Indians. Are you saying that he wanted to exterminate them?
I think that's a questionable, it's based in something else. So it has to do with, understanding culture and whether or not you can actually, help someone by Christianizing them.
Right, but pause for a moment, because see, part of education is making distinctions, right? Let's say I believe as a Christian that your life would be infinitely better than it is if you became a Christian. And in that sincere belief, I read the Bible to you and I start proselytizing you. I'm not Adolf Hitler. You may not go for it. You may think that I'm conning you, but you can't deny that my motivation is actually to save your immortal soul. And what I'm getting at is that for you then to say this is genocide and not be able to even back off from that, even though we're looking at a very specific case where you know there's no evidence to support your position, but you're so dug in ideologically that it would twist your mind to admit, look, it's a long distance from Eliezer Wheelock to Hitler. And yes, and trying to convert somebody, even if it's ultimately going to mean changing their culture, even if you think that that's a bad idea, it doesn't mean that they thought that, and it doesn't make them into the evil caricature that you're trying to make out. Now,
we also understand the multiple harmful effects of
music. I think we should do that. And I think that the most harmful effect today, if you look at the Indian reservation, and I've actually spent time on the Indian reservation. When I lived in Arizona, I got a... Pardon? No, when I lived in Arizona, I got an up-close look at American Indian reservations for a whole year. And here's what I want to say. The tragedy of the American Indian today is the abject sense of hopelessness and dependency. And you cannot deny that that dependency is cunningly exploited by a political party that harvests 90% of its vote. So, on the Indian reservation, there's a book you should read that talks about the Indian reservation. It's just called The Res. And the guy starts off by saying, on the Indian reservation, he goes, there's no Starbucks. There's no 7-Eleven. There are not even any billboards. There are no ads for medical doctors. In other words, it's a place defined by desolation. And he goes, and interestingly, the people who run it want it that way. And that's the point I want to stress. It is that we are dealing with a new kind of oppression, very different than the kind. You're fighting the oppression, if you will, of the 1600s. You're still mad about Columbus, yeah. Right? And what you aren't doing is actually going on a reservation and seeing what it is about those people's lives. You know, things like we could use some elementary sanitation on the reservation. And it would be really nice if people weren't being shot at night without any cops showing up. And it would be really nice if there were some jobs actually available and companies that would have incentives to come here. And why isn't any of that happening? And who's blocking it and why? Yes, it is. But it's, alas, going to be a topic for another day. I want to thank you all for coming. It's really been fun. Thank you very much. Thank you.